Thank you so much, Ramesh, for a very generous introduction. Excellency Matsutsuga Asakawa, President of Asian Development Bank, all other colleagues, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, very good morning to all of you. Early this year, the COVID-19 pandemic occurs suddenly and unpredictably, unprecedented. And that has exposed us to health crisis like never happened before. As the virus is easily transmitted from human to human, almost all countries in the world have to take stringent measures such as social distancing and mobility restriction to contain the spread. The mobility restriction has been effective in preventing the spread of COVID, but resulted in high economic costs as well as business activity, which is restricted. Many people's lives and livelihoods are affected severely. Although some business owners, they are able to seek refuge in digital world, and some business activity continue to survive despite the substantial decline in demand. This pandemic underscored the importance of technology, especially digital technology, as a critical enabling tool in this time of health crisis. COVID-19 pandemic has accelerated the digitalization process and transformed the way we live, we learn, and earn a living. Technology has helped many of us survive in this challenging situation. Social distancing implemented has pushed many companies, people, and the government to be creative and utilizing technology, such as implementing remote working, online schooling, and e-commerce. Technology has provided us with multiple possibilities through various innovation platforms and tools, applications to make our life easier, especially during this pandemic. Technology development reshaped industries, restructured market, and redefined competitive advantage. It is not immediately clear who the winners and losers will be, or the role of the policymaker can play in fostering inclusive growth driven by this technological change. Some degree of consensus exists on the potential large-scale impact of emerging technology in both advanced and developing economy. Each country has a unique mix of economic structure and area of specialization. Its firms participate in activity within global value chains and use technology at varying level of sophistication. As such, the impact of new technology will differ in different countries and in their various economic sectors. For policymakers, the challenge is to understand the policy responses that are required to reap the benefit of new technologies while anticipating any associated risk. It is crucial that we have sound information based on robust research. This will enable us to understand the impact of new technologies and to devise and implement effective policy. Our policy making must be founded on solid knowledge and forecasts that help us identify where opportunity and which investment can spur growth. We need to consider those affected in the process and those who lose in this transformation. The CSIS research suggests that only one from five jobs could shift to technology-based, the remain could not. Thus, while supporting digitalization, we need to consider those four jobs who could not change to technology-based and provide platform or mechanism for them to keep up with this transformation. On the user side, digital divide, as mentioned also by President Asakawa, is still huge, especially in developing economy. or a country as large as Indonesia with a variety of access to the internet. Internet access is still a luxury for some people or some region. This has significantly limited the benefit and success of its application for public service delivery. For example, while online learning has been conducted to accommodate student needs during the social distancing period, not all students have the access to internet or mobile devices. Some even are digitally illiterate, making them prone to experiencing losses in education during the pandemic. Many micro and small businesses, particularly in the remote area, are not yet engaged with technology because of the internet access gap. These are kinds of problems that are still faced by a lot of ASEAN countries. While we know that we should take advantage of the momentum provided by this crisis, we also must work harder to fill the divide. Looking at the huge shock we face for this pandemic, our investment in this area are crucial to equip us with better resilience in the future. Like many other countries, Indonesia digital transformation has rapidly accelerated, particularly since the imposition of the large-scale social restriction policy at the onset of this COVID-19 outbreak. We provided, in order for us to narrow the digital divide, many of the government's support for the internet access. We provided first for the electricity subsidy for the 40% bottom of the population, and provided internet free for students, teachers, as well as higher education. These are all trying to provide the facility which has become a backbone during this COVID-19 pandemic. We also put critical support for micro and small medium enterprises in transition and implementing digital transformation to ensure its ability in adapting to the new business model. To this end, the government of Indonesia has developed a number of initiatives to better equip the country in addressing opportunity and challenges arising from emerging technologies. The government of Indonesia, through Ministry of Communication and Information, has launched 1,000 startups movement that encourages the emergence of new IT-based startups until 2024. For the next stage of their business development, the government has launched the CORN program to seek potential startups to receive financing. We also provide, at the highest stage of their development, the government provides full support for Unicorn and Decacorn through its supporting human resource development program, as well as regulatory and infrastructure development. For this infrastructure development, we are committed to improve connectivity across the country. Indonesia is a huge archipelago country. And to accelerate the development of our digital economy, last year, we have reached another milestone in our connectivity development when we finished building a Palapa Ring broadband project using public-private partnership scheme. A 35,000 kilometer long fiber optic network spanning throughout the archipelago. This broadband data network supports not only high quality data exchange for communication purposes, but also to deliver a quality of education and health services content throughout the country. Our next in line, we will continue to build Satria 1 multifunction satellite. This is the high throughput satellite, also using public-private partnership scheme. The Minister of Finance supporting with all fiscal tools in order to make this project happen. this telecommunication infrastructure development becoming a very critical and strategic for our digital transformation. The project would hopefully allow Indonesia citizens equal and affordable access to high-speed internet. On the other hand, our structural reform focus on improving productivity and competitiveness, reinvigorating industrialization, and nurturing innovation. As a finance minister, I also make sure that the local government spending on the internet will be allocated through the earmark. These are all to make sure that they can access all the infrastructure which is becoming available to the whole area of Indonesia. Our policy to drive reform, including digitalization and innovation, are reflected on 2021 next year's state budget. The big theme of our policy is accelerating economic recovery from COVID and strengthening reform. We are not going to waste this COVID-19 crisis. So we accelerate reform even faster. The fiscal deficit for next year was set at 5.7% of GDP. This is especially to accommodate many priority, including supporting the recovery process, but most importantly, in ICT investment. For the ICT sector development, the government expanded our budget support to $2 billion from its 2021 budget. We also use the state budget to push for more connectivity. There are still 12,000 more villages which is not yet connected. So we are targeted 4,000 villages and sub-districts in Indonesia in the outermost and least developed frontier to be connected for next year. To realize this goal, to be more digitalized and to keep up with the Industry 4.0, we will make sure that infrastructure will reach to the most remote area. Finally, in driving forward our digitalization effort, the urgency of bridge digital divide should be continuously resonated on the world stage. And I'm glad that the ADB is also committed to do that. Stronger cooperation has to be promoted as COVID-19 brings a lot of economic disruption that can only be corrected quickly through synergy and collaboration. We have to ensure that countries around the world and all of its people can get fairer opportunity in tapping the benefit of digitalization. It is equally important to continue balancing the level of digital playing field, that's including through a sound and fair taxation policy, which Indonesia always resound and support on this global stage. I'm glad ADB also is going to pay attention on this taxation area, and we will working together at the G20 as well as OECD in order for us to be able to establish a good practice on a global taxation policy that fair for all country. In closing, I would like to convey my appreciation again to ADB for hosting this event and look forward for it to come up with internationally policy recommendation or any initiative that can be adopted by member countries of ADB in supporting their technological transformation. Thank you so much.